Yep.
Well, I don't intend to speak that much. I just want to sort of kick off a discussion. I think we need to consider making support levels visible to users for leaseful packages in optional and extra priorities, because there are plenty of packages there that do not have a maintainer or have an inactive maintainer, and where bugs, quite serious bugs, may go unfixed for a long time because there's no one who really knows how to fix them. There's also the case of maintainers who don't understand the code in their packages. This is okay if they have very active upstreams who can help with fixed bugs, but where upstream isn't particularly active either, or doesn't support old versions, such as we have in Debian Stable, by the end of release, then there's no one who can easily fix bugs. So I think users ought to have some sort of clue as to how well we can support those packages, because clearly not all packages are equal. Moritz spoke about how security coverage really doesn't cover all our packages. And also, I'm not sure everyone knows that it doesn't cover non-free, generally. So, any ideas for how we can do this?
I would go far to actually classify them instead of rather recommend against removing packages more aggressively. We don't actually need all those 50,000 packages. We have a lot of duplication inside the archive. It's also terribly difficult for local administrators to actually choose which one of the packages is best suited for a certain field of application. We have about 10 to 15 different small memory, low memory footprint HDDs inside the archive. We don't really all need this. The differences will be quite marked. And no one really has the time to check all the 15 minimal HDDD packages, whether they are the most suited for a field of application. So I guess removing more packages would actually, you wouldn't lose anything and still gain quite a lot.
Yeah, we've had this discussion on, I don't actually remember whether it was on Devel or private, but the consensus seemed to be that most people were happy with quantity, and so I can understand that your point of view. You want to improve quality versus quantity. I agree with you, but I don't think we can. I think we can bring the general body of developers along with us on that.
Concerning the recommendation, I also don't agree because I think that maybe having, for example, making HTTPs in the archive is a way to let the people have the freedom to choose, and especially if you've got a problem, let's say with Apache Foundation, sometime in the future, you can still have LGHTTPD to replace it or something like that. In other words, you are not bound to any other vendors and any other providers of HTTP because you have many. So you get a real freedom regarding this. So I think that some package should have we should pay more attention to some package because they are more important than they are more used than others. I don't think that removing more packages is a good solution, except if the maintainer is MER. In this case, yes, you can remove the package.
Yeah, but just because someone wants to maintain a spare package does actually not mean that he should impose all the work on all the other core teams who are affected by that. If someone wants to have his minimal HTTPD in the archive just because he's the author, we have quite a lot of these. So, I wrote this in University Code 10 years ago, and I think I still use it somewhere in my private network, so I think it should be in the archive. This actually puts all the work on all the other teams, like the QA team, whenever it goes, missing in action, it imposes work with the security whenever there's a problem discovered in his pet package. it's also likewise for the lead team, like managing transitions. And I don't think nobody can ever check all these. I don't think it actually brings any benefit, because if you search for a low memory footprint HTTP, you will never have the time to actually check what all these 15 are suited. There shouldn't be a situation where we only have Apache, but I don't think all these duplications really serve the
The problem is what's actually working okay, I think, is if there are some really great bugs that are reported as RC, the packages are nowadays moved very fast in testing. So I don't think the release team really cares that much. What the problem is if these packages, problematic are packages that are broken, but nobody ever reported the bug against them.
There is the issue of people try a package, it just doesn't work, and they go on and try something else, and then that wastes the time of everyone else after them who tries it.
So that's one point. Is there a way to get people to test out packages and then also report if they are severely broken? That's one problem. And I wanted to say something else. The general problem of UA removing packages because the maintainer is MIA, or at least often them and then later remove them. The problem remains that this is a very manual task and very individual, because So the question is, can we automatize this better? So, I don't really have a point, I just wanted to say that's the problem.
I have a one thing I was noticing is, so you want to make levels visible to users, like support levels somehow. A potential way to be through that bit, you can have like a support passive. The thing is, if that happens, I would like to have only positive aspects listed in it.
Sure.
Otherwise,
yes,
they become shame marks. But it would still be, you know, whatever is not positive is negative. So one could say, you know, this is maintained by security, supported by a security team. Okay, I prefer it over one that doesn't. This is orphaned. This has had no activity since years. Now that needs to be weighted against login and things that don't need maybe. But if we can come out with a decently measurable list of qualitative positive aspects that could solve the problem of making it visible to users, and we can just distribute it through that place. And about security support, Moritz, do you think it could be a good idea to allow to shift security support for some very low priority packages to the package maintainer?
Like what this was actually done to a certain extent, that we don't prepare all the updates for ourselves. Some packages we can't really do it by ourselves anyhow, because package that is quite complicated. So at least testing the update needs to be done by a maintainer. We don't have any possibility to, for example, test the voiceover IP package, because we don't have the necessary hardware in place. And for complex fixes, we also need the maintainer. But problem is that many of these fringe packages don't even have an active maintainer. Someone uploaded it 3 years ago, and no one has hasn't really seen him. He might not even be missing in action, but because the texture is so low maintenance, because it doesn't receive, doesn't require real maintenance, because it's just a package which few people use and few people report bugs against. I think it, we kind of have a kind of implicit security support scope already. For example, if you have a if you find a denial of service vulnerability, it will be fixed very, very quickly. If you find a denial of service vulnerability in a minimal DNS server, it's even quite likely that we won't fix it at all because it has so few users, and that's quite a the margin between security problem and generic bug is quite slim that we are.
Right, because I was thinking, if that could help you, one could make it explicit to say security team doesn't care about this package somehow, and that allows people who maintain fringe packages used by I don't know, some academic target group. I'm thinking that I maintain like meteorology packages, and there's not many weather centers use Debian, I mean, but still I try to be as accurate as possible in terms of that, and I don't want to put the load on you. But
yeah, well, fringe packages typically don't impose a very much load on the security. All the certificate applications rarely have security problems. The only applications which actually put a disproportionate amount of work are mostly web applications, but we're thinking of different ways to support them. So this would actually go into the direction of imposing the work onto the maintainers themselves. So if it would be maintained in volatile, it would be likely up to the maintainer themselves to update the package. But this only affects maybe 20 packages. The problem is that most of the security bugs in, for example, minimal HTTPDs are not spotted at all.
Okay.
So we don't even notice them, and if we notice them, which is rarely the case, then of course we fix them, and it's not that much work, it's not a problem. I think the main problem here is that most people won't notice them. There's no specific review of all these packages, there are no independent security researchers or companies like Secunia or iDefense which have a look at them, and we also don't receive bug reports from them which indicate that there could be a security problem.
And there's also been a discussion in the previous days of doing something like the cleanup of bike sheds in Amsterdam, in which you get a bike shed which is full of bike, all very old broken bikes, and people put stickers on all the bikes that look dodgy, and the sticker says that if you don't take the bike away within 2 weeks, we'll come pick it up and send it to a bicycle recycling center. And so the idea was that whenever there's like packages that have not had RC bugs, and I've had them for like months, and they last upload was an enemy, or you know, those that look dodgy, we open an RC bug of them saying, well, close it within 2 months, or we file for removal. Which would kind of, all those developers that may uploaded something 3 years ago but don't care about it anymore would have an excuse to let it just go, because they would have to do nothing else particularly.
Yeah, that's already been done. So if whenever we're feeling that a package isn't really poor shape, or that it's inherently insecure or broken otherwise, for example, we had that for a few web applications already. We filed the security bug report with release critical severity, and a few months later we check again and it's still present, and the maintainer didn't reply. We tried to fix it with our own resources, which is often quite difficult because no one really understands the obscure web application, or you need to get to the details for quite some time. But after that we always file a removal bug, which are processed pretty quickly right now, rather FTP masters, and then it takes longer than a month. And I don't think there's ever been a case that one of these removal requests has been declined, so this is actually already been done.
Okay.
But one last note, please. It's only the case for all the packages which are actually where someone spotted a security problem. So all the applications really didn't, of course we could find a release of the security bugs for all and just invent some, but this would be alright.
Oh, okay, here's just to apply a cleanup security. No, cleanup for the critical bugs.
Okay. Yeah, we did something like that about the sticker thing. After Edge was released, we looked at packages which were not which were unstable at the time of the freeze, but were not in Edge, so basically packages that missed the release. And we fed RC bugs against those that we thought that should be orphaned or removed. But it's very hard to say if a specific package should be just orphaned or removed. It's difficult to decide when you don't know the package. So we can ask the maintainer, but obviously it doesn't answer if it's semi-orphaned.
Ask the maintainer, if they don't answer, you remove the package.
Yeah, but if the package sometimes has users, so sometimes it's better to orphan it first and then remove it, and then it takes about 1 year between the time you spot the problem, you orphan it, maybe it's 3 months later, then you it's a very long process actually.
Right. Users don't know what's orphaned. We can go and check what's orphaned. Users typical users I suspect have no idea.
Yeah. Actually we should rotate
orphan back. I think we also need a way to redraw or to withdraw security support packages in stable places. For example, during body lifetime we have this problem with Mozilla, that there was no security support and basically the kernel wasn't supported either. And so there must be a way for users of stable that they see if the state of the package changes and it's no longer supported. And if we just remove the package from stable, like as been suggested for some packages, and the user won't see it either, because if he just does upget this upgrade, there will be no warning to this.
I think we all have our best practices in choosing a package. For example, when I for the first time install a package which I've never tried, or when I have to choose among different software which is not do basically the same thing, I have some habits, like I go to the bug tracking system and I see how many bugs are going to work against this package. Maybe I have to get the rules and look at the last time they did the change log and this kind of stuff. And I think it can be worthwhile to like start sharing these habits. Maybe we can collect them on a wiki page and see how many of them can be formalized and checked automatically. And if it's possible, we can use the tagging ID or something like that to tag this package failed, this like best practice for looking at the quality of the package. But I don't think it's really possible to avoid the blaming side of creating the quality for package.
So one of the ideas that we had like with PAPS and like that could fit into the UI community would be to have user-centric reviews of packages. Amazon style, like maybe with a star mark or something, that could be also used to not only like bugs, but also the whole package usability. Because sometimes you have software, you know, it's not buggy, but pretty useless because of, I don't know, it doesn't have all the features. And so you could use that kind of mark to actually know better if it's a possible candidate for removal or something.
Do you mean something like a weighted button?
No, something like Amazon reviews of books.
No, I mean this package. Oh, certainly.
Conceptually, I think it's more ratings.
Yeah.
Like user ratings for each package, like what's fine or pretty broken. I think that's what
like basic idea, like Amazon book review. I mean, they, you know, you have to put a mark on the page, and that could be I don't know, a level that could vary on a wide scale for every single user. They
could use popcorn.
No. You can have to use popcorn because I can have a package on only one of my machine, but it's essential for my work. I mean, That's a different metric. You can have packages that are very important for some people, and that would actually be important to keep in the archive for that precise reason. But if the package is always like 3 stars out of 10, it's a candidate for removal. But you will always have also a text entry with that, that you could read and try to understand what's going on. But we're going to talk more about that during the DDN community talk.
I have also an argument against the removal of package. I think that we should not fall into the same scheme as the Red Hat has. I mean that we have a small set of packages which are maintained officially, and a lot of packages around in the wild that are not in our repository, but in other repositories that we don't control, and that we can't even test for build. So if you remove packages, you will put these packages in other repository, because even if it's only useful to one person, you will create many dead packages in the wild, and we could run into a higher security problem, because people will make more and more very specific setup, and they will put packages in it. For example, if you get a package that only that require a very old version of GTK, for example, the people will take this package and will take GTK and we inject it in Sarge because we need it, and you will get something very complicated. And I think for security reason, you will get something very complicated and very unreproducible at large scale. And maybe it's not. I'm okay that certain package should not have security support, and that should be marked using dev tags or something like that, just like a star on the package saying Apache is maintained by, is supported by a security team, and Boa or LGHTTPD is not maintained by a security team. Okay,
yeah.
But we should not remove it from
the package.
As direct response, I agree with you that Debian very profits from not having many external repositories. There are some, but they are quite known. And so I agree with you to aggressively remove packages just for the sake of having removing it and making it easier for security support. I think we need some other solution. I think there is some agreement that we should somehow mark packages we cannot really give the same care as we do for our, I say, my main packages. Has there already been some consensus? How do we want to mark the packages? I mean, Ubuntu is using an extra section on the FTP server. Do we want something like this in Debian? Do we want to go with dev tags? The advantage of dev tags would be that we can change these tags more easily than re-uploading it to another section of the archive. I'm not sure how we do that. I would feel fine with dev tags, but I don't know how the others feel about that.
Personally, I agree with you. I think that text could be a really good way of adding meta information to our packages.
Right.
It's just a problem of control. I mean, it's a secret team which decides who what packages are supported and which aren't. And currently, that text is like Enrico only. No way.
I can pull data from the security team, not maybe override completely whatever. I mean, tag input is wild and just manual review, but then I can, after manual review, just pull in whatever the security team gives me and have it be below. Like I can say, from the web tagging interface, I don't get any of these tags. I cut them out and I pull them in from the security team. So they can be as reviewed as you want.
Okay, let's see what I want. Yeah, I want to try to come back to something someone said earlier. I think currently it's not so much a problem for experienced sysadmin to rate packages, because you really can look at the popcom score, the bugs score, and past DSAs, and you can get a pretty good picture of what software you should use in your company or on your commercial server or something like that. I think it's really the problem more for an unexperienced end user, because he probably can't do that, or he doesn't know how to do it, or how to rate this information he gets. It really requires that we get this information. And I think users rating packages is really a good idea, and we should do that, but it doesn't solve the security side of it, because the users won't be able to judge the security of an application they use. It's more about this aspect, like, I tried it and it was completely broken, and I think if there's a clear, if there's an easy website where I can easily say that without filing a bug report, I think it should be possible to increase the numbers of or the percentage of feedback we get there. And I would also agree that we shouldn't like Ubuntu make like main and universe, because we will not be able to do that without like having a constant flame war for about 6 months, yeah, and some smaller flame wars after that, and also because there should really be like DevTex or something that would be really more flexible. So I wanted to ask Enrico, how does this DevTex information munging currently work? Is that is this like a repository where you commit that, or
The workflow is the current workflow from the official Debian tag source is that there's a web interface to tag packages that goes into an unreviewed tag database. The unreviewed tag database is periodically checked by myself, and so I remove junk if I spot it, and it goes into a reviewed tag database, which is maintained on subversion, so we can get any older versions if anything screws up, and that goes then to the packages file. At any point, I control all the workflows, so I cannot anything we want, really. We have some bot that computes some metric.
But it would be easy possible to, like, if there would be more work on that, to extend the group that reviews this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, you do it yourself at the moment, and
if
we would use that text more, it could be more work. And
all the scripts, there's no problem, I can give them to people, it's fine. It just needs to, you know the tag vocabulary. So at the moment there's just not many people that do. But I welcome any people that would like to help me. And if there is information from other sources, like a list of packages the security team likes more, or list of orphan packages, that when that is information that is absolutely objective, doesn't need any review, we take it from there, we stick it directly in the tag database.
Yeah, you said earlier that it is better to use positive tags,
yeah,
or something like that, but especially for something like security support, I don't really see how to do that. Because otherwise you just have to add the tag security support to all packages and then remove it slowly.
Yeah, absolutely. Totally.
That sounds like a lot of redundant information.
That's fine. Just a bit.
Okay.
I think we're having a small problem with this discussion, because we are talking about removing packages which are not useful, removing all the crap from the archive, which is a good thing. But we currently have about 15,000 packages. Even if we manage to remove 1,000 packages, which are scraps, that must be approximately what it is, it is not going to help security support at all, because there will be 14,000 packages left, and it's not such a big difference. But I think that for the to find out which package are not used anymore, something good would be to have a policy, for example, of not releasing orphaned packages. This would force maintainers to adopt the packages that are orphaned, because many of them are used, and they could find maintainers, even if this goes through sponsored upload by non-DBs. And yeah, I think that's something that we should discuss with the release team, maybe.
I agree that our package should be assay box package, yes. I think it could be useful.
I just want to say that if we were going to split the archives, say main and universe, in such a way that say 20-30% of packages goes to main, the rest goes to universe, really change anything, because then users would say, I don't, I need this, I have to use universe, and then forget about it and be back to square one.
Okay, I think also that the splitting of main universe is not super useful. It's black and white, and we have colored word. But I think we must put the information easily to the I think some text like this is on the popcorn wave, the first 100 packets, the first 1,000 packets, and so.
Can I interrupt you just a second? I think we're going to speak up to be heard over the construction.
Okay.
About popcorn, we can sort by popcorn now in package managers, as long as people notice that they alter library in the last 2 weeks that brings that data. We don't need tags for it.
Maurice?
Yeah, just want to reconfirm that different archive suits are not suitable. We can see that with Ubuntu, which just provides security support for about 10% of all packages that it actually provides security support for, while need all the users are forced to include one of application or the other, so there's basically quite a, if you install in Ubuntu system, you'll always, nearly always run into a situation where you have unsupported software. Sometimes, if there's enough pressure from the user base, I think they still issue some security updates for their unsupported universe directory, but other than that, I don't think that's a really good idea.
I think I want to clarify here about the situation with universe in Ubuntu and why they are doing that. The main point why they are separating main from universe is that they have a company who promises to provide security support for main. In fact, there is security. We have infrastructure to do security support in universe as well, and I have already done some security uploads for universe, but it's just lack of manpower. And I think the main point why Ubuntu is separating is to make it very clear to the end user to say, if you're enabling these repositories, it is possible that you get packages for which you can't request commercial support from Canonical. So this does not suit Debian very well. I agree with that. But if we want to have something similar, to have some sort of two-class society of packages, we still need to provide our users some means to clearly say, well, you have these packages installed for which our security support is not able to give you support, or for which Debian is not having the resources to really care for them. And I'm not sure how to make this. Perhaps we can integrate this in APT or apt-cache, or I have no idea. But I really think if we say, no, we want not this archive split, which I agree that it's not very suitable to Debian, we still need to think about some way to make it very clear which packages are first-class citizens and which packages are second-class citizens.
I absolutely think that it must be integrated, because all other ways on the page if you install a package, then maybe there should be a warning, like now this for if the signature fails, then there should be a warning. These special packages don't have security support. Do you really want to install them? So I really think we need such an integration app.
I don't know if that's like one possibility I see is also to redefine a little bit what volatile is. Because I don't know, if like we had an upstream that doesn't want to provide us security support, or even they don't want to support their previous version at all, like we've seen recently with the unfree business. Whatever, these packages could be moved to volatile. I mean, like, you have some PHP web apps that could very well shoot in volatile because they are, like, you know, held to maintain a security standpoint, and I think it would be, like, quite a possible solution to try to move some packages and that. But it will mean, like, still adding volatile, more integrating it a little bit more closely in Debian. Like, I mean, we need a question in the Debian installer to allow users to know volatile DB. And we'll need also, I think, better, well, collective responsibility of what's inside volatile. And we'll have to also draw a line at some point, and that's going to be saying what's tricky, possible.
I really think that it should be only an option of APT in fact, just like you configure your sources.list, you can configure this option just to say it's an option in APT, APT security only, and you just get yes to this true to this. This value for configuring APT, and every time you try to install a package that is not supported by security team, just warn you and ask you another question saying, just like when you try to upload a package, to download a package that is not signed, you get a warning. Here you get a warning if you try to install a non-security supported package on your system, as you have checked this option. So just really one more question in APT configuration using a Debian installer, and for people who have already something installed, it's just be one more option to APT, and think it would be light and easy to use.
So
another
dev tag could have automatic data that and recur would be old standard version in Debian slash control. Like if it's, you know, the package is an outdated, uses an outdated version of the policy, because that would show, you know, some.
Is that actually useful?
Like, it's a metric to measure, like, that a package is often uploaded.
You can
test
that.
Yeah.
Only in terms of the end of the so
yeah, it is. Suppose I have like login, which doesn't require maybe uploads for 3 years, and it turns out there's been 9 policy updates, none of which requires any changes in login. Do I have to update a new version of login just to change that version?
There's login information that's useful to developers, but probably not to the average Debian user. We as developers can probably look that up on the package page or the SQA page.
It could be useful to know if the standard version is old and there's been policy changes that affect that package.
Well,
yes,
you can't tell.
But exactly, it can't automatically. So
don't have to be.
And if you can, those are actually bugs.
Yeah.
So
that could be, to summarize, that could be maybe the NGN unclean sticker. I don't know.
Also has too many false positives, I guess. I don't know. So if we if we want to support some packages more too volatile, it probably needs to be in the default sources list that is installed by the AI. Probably not uncommented. It should be commented out, but currently I don't think that many users actually know that it exists.
Yeah, and it's very underused. I just looked, and there are I think 11 packages there, but there's a lot of scope to expand that, I think. Just going back to the various suggestions of how you would measure, how you would do have how you would come up with support metrics, I don't really think any of these are going to work. I think it comes down to human judgment, and I think a large part of the input has to come from the package maintainer, moderated by, if the maintainer is no longer contactable, then it's not supported.
I maintain a package where a stream is mostly inactive, for example. I'm willing to fix any single bug that would be reported to me, but I know that AppStream is basically not interesting to maintain that package, like the program, the software anymore. I don't know if that's a metric that is interesting to have, for example.
Yeah, I think that doesn't say anything at all in itself, because for some packages you really you can say I'm the maintainer, but I wouldn't be but I'm just not able to fix exotic bugs because I don't understand the software well enough. Like, there are packages that I maintain, I don't think I actually maintain them anymore, but where I had no clue how they were, yeah. But there was nobody else that wanted to maintain it, and so I maintained it. But there are other packages, if upstream vanishes, it's not a big deal, because you understand the software just as well. So, but it could be useful if you say, I maintain this software and I fix packaging bugs, but I don't, but I can't really touch the code, yeah, because I will break something. I think what we have said so far boils down to there should be a way for the security team to clearly denote packages that they don't care, that they can't support anymore in stable. I mean, in unstable you can just file an RC bug, probably. And for orphan packages, you have always the maintainer field, so you can see if a package is orphan. But I don't know if this information currently actually tickles down from unstable. So if it's orphan after release, it will probably be useful to have this information available in the stable patches file. The problem we haven't talked about much anymore is like we have a huge pile of software in the archive where we don't know how it if it works or something like that. Where the packages where we have the information, it's a matter of giving this information to the user, but the other problem of getting the information is completely separate from that.
I just want to note if there's such a mechanism in place which knows where a feature is embedded in an app that it wants, that a package is unsupported, would be very useful if that could be that could not only be used for packages which we are known to be not supportable at the beginning of release, but also retroactively right now. We have the situation that we're no longer able to support Mozilla in Sarge, because every 4 to 6 months there's a new Mozilla release which fixes up to 40 security problems, and no other distribution besides Debian does black ports. We did this. We just prepared a final Mozilla update for Sarge, but the Mozilla maintainers were unable to actually find any testers which were able or willing to test this package, so we're not actually able to support it. We just put a note to the recent Mozilla advisories that it's no longer supported, but I'm not sure how many of the users actually read this. There are some conceptually broken features now in the new app, which allows you to even install security updates unattended, which does not work. I wrote this in the eval, but most people do not seem to care. So this will likely stay inside the new app features, which will even worsen the whole problem even further. So I think it would be quite good that such a mechanism could even be applied retroactively, so that maybe, I don't know, is the information about DevTags all stored inside the DevTags package, or is it
no,
all
in the package file?
It's in the package file, right, the final, yeah.
Okay, so if a new Mozilla, so for example, if Mozilla would be discontinued, we could just issue a new Mozilla package which includes a new DevTag that is unsupported.
It's added to override files.
You don't need to upload. No, I see.
There's an override at FTP master site. On the other hand, the information may not be easy to attach to a specific version.
Well,
so
yeah,
the override file has package name, list of files. There's no version information in it.
Yeah, but so currently it is like it applies to all suits for old stable to unstable. They have all the same tags, or is it by suit? So has stable different overrides from testing?
The thing is, the overrides are uploaded to unstable. They will go to testing. You make the stable release, they will stay in.
Okay, so we don't have currently a way to change the dev text information in stable.
You can edit the overrides for stable if needed, but it's
impossible to make it.
Okay,
you don't have to ask the FTP masters about it.
But this could be fixed by having a suit-specific contract. So if that's the problem, that for example, a dev tag, no security support applies to all groups, you could just create dev tags for no security support and such no security support edge. So I think that's much more.
Yeah, okay. So it boils down to we have to ask the FTP masters how easy this would be to change, that we can edit dev tags.
I took some notes. So we've been talking about possibly auto-generated tags, like the packages old friend, the maintainer kind of looks like Mia, or there's all the RC bugs. We have in-generated tags like security team, one support for this suit. We could have tags introduced by the maintainer itself, herself, in the control file. Like I could declare in the control file that this package is a fringe package, or I could declare that upstream is dead, or I could declare that upstream is dead, but I will fix bugs. Those are all things that the maintainer can declare, and then someone can know that, for example, dead upstream, but if he will fix bugs, then maybe I can put it into production, as long as I'm happy with the current feature list. Whereas if I instead hope that it will be better, I may consider either becoming upstream or installing something else. So that could help. So there could be some, auto. I don't mind putting a fringe tag in some of my packages. I know they are fringe, and I maintain for those fringes.
What's fringe tag?
Used by not many people. Maybe, I don't know, things for biology, meteorology,
obscure.
Obscure, yeah.
you can have
that. I would just like to come back to the how to find packages that are wrapped. Basically, you just have to find the list of sources of information and get a scoring mechanism to say, okay, this one was not uploaded for the last 2 years, so it gets once 10 points, for example. And if the package reaches 20 points or something, then you add it to your list of questionable packages and that you have to review. But that's just something that can be automated, that the review cannot get. And that's quite trivial to do. So
yeah,
just
I suggest you do a, you make a prototype for the automation and look at it carefully, because scoring are good when the price of a bad scoring is low, but when the price you pay in case the scoring is bad is very high, then scoring are dangerous because you will have corner cases.
Yeah, but then you have to review the package. It's not about removing them automatically. So
right,
just to get a first list of what should be reviewed.
Yes, and at that point you might want to contact the maintainers or make a list of maintainers for packages that are possibly not properly maintained.
Well, I won't do that myself, but if someone wants to tell us that, I can help. And I already have quite a lot of information.
Yeah, I just want to know that another very useful check would be suited for local use only. We've had at least one case suited for local use only. We've had at least one case for Edge where we had the option to either drop the package. The case is SQL Ledger. Although there's a fork of the code base which might clean the code base up in the foreseeable future. The current version is not, but I think it's a web-based double
account. Double entry account.
Yeah, double entry account existing. And I think it's completely fine to have such to declare that such a solution is not exposed to the untrusted public internet, because if you grant public access to your double to your accounting, you have worse problems than actually SQL. And there's I'm not sure how many of the users actually read the readme.debian.security file, but I think it's still fine because the typical field of the typical usage scenario for this package will only be local authenticated use anyway. So and I guess there are quite some other packages in the archive which would probably some such attack.
Would this be maintained by the security team or the maintainer?
Yeah, by security team, but with the limitations that, for example, if you if there's a vulnerability which only affects a usage scenario where you have an untrusted external attacker or an untrusted person authenticated, then this will not be fixed. So that the specific declares that it is security support, but only for a sane application scenario.
We're actually running out of time here, so. One or two last comments.
Yeah, I had two other ideas for these facets. One could be software development status, like alpha, beta, stable, mature, data stream, whatever it is. And what I don't know if that would be interesting, because but like a tag maintainer is a user of the package is I don't know if that's clear, because you know, sometimes you just get package on your hands but don't use it anymore, but there's no one willing to step up to do so, and I think like it's a lot better if the maintainer is the user of the
I like this one, because that allows you to maintain playground packages in unstable. But at the moment they just migrate all the way to stable, and at least with this type we could actually know that this is something intended for, you know, share it while I develop it, instead of build it for stable.
That's exactly what RFA is for. Like a request for adoption.
Oh.
You can offer it for adoption without actually offering it. So you should really file this bucket instead of just taking your package.
No, no, but this is a development status, like alpha, beta, intended for production.
Yeah, I meant the second one. The I don't use this package anymore. So
good point.
Yeah, but if you don't want to release the statement, you should file a series pseudo document. It will be removed from testing and not released. So it's also possible. A lot of people are doing this if they have one package more advanced.
We have very useful 0.7 version packages in stable.
UDEF.
Yeah, but the maintenance can decide if he doesn't need a special tag for that.
But for packages that are not intended to go to a stable release, maybe the best would be to upload to experimental, because experimental now works fine, but good building network, and there's no reason not to use it. Stupid to upload to unstable and just to file an RC bug saying no, it's not intended for a stable release. And this would help with the tagging.
There's a lot of developers that are using, not Debian developers, just plain developers that are using unstable because that's where they find the last version of their libraries.
I think experimental use is today quite safe because I think it's automatically pinned down by app unless
yes.
you the problem, there are some problems with experimental, like the built-in network exists but it's unofficial, and not for all arches it's reliable, so there are still advantages of using unstable for such reasons. I don't know. I think the release team already suggests to people they have such a bug for a long time. Often this package is not suitable for stable to move it to experimental. But there might be cases where it's not really suitable. Like for example, it's good that GCC snapshot. It's actually good that GCC snapshot is unstable, because this is a package where you really need builds for all architectures, and you just don't get that in experimental at the moment.
Yeah, so these three snapshots could be tagged not for production, sort of, doing not.
Yeah, but you will want to have the RC bug again open against it, because that's visible for developers. So.
Right, we maybe should continue this on Debian-QA, or?
I have some very short minutes of different ideas, if you want, I can just be on them.
Okay.
Some are planning on coordinating such activities, or because problem with many BIOS is that quite a lot of people have many ideas, but not the time to actually implement them and keeping the interested persons together.
What,
so.
What would be the best way to ask to discuss with the FTP masters about the FTP about the DevTex?
Just
ask AJ,
he's very responsible.
So it's probably good to CC them or something like that, if we discuss this on Debian QA.
But so far most of these tags can actually just go to unstable.
Except for the security box.
If there are things that change on security after stable is released, that is what we discuss with the FTP masters. But I suppose it's kind of rare things happening.
Anyway, we have the time until Lenny is released to implement such a thing.
No, but what I mean is a change to a security tag in stable is probably an event which happens twice during the lifetime of stable, or in that case there's no scripts to be written. It's just
I
edit the override file.
Okay, yeah.